Sociologist perspective. Our speaker and guest is Professor Seif Da'Na of the Sociology Department of UW Parkside. He is chairman of the Sociology and Anthropology Department. It will be the Roots of ISIS, a Sociologist Perspective, and we're very pleased to have Dr. Da'Na with us. With no further ado, Professor Da'Na.
Thank you.
Can you hear me well? Okay. Good evening. And thank you for the introduction and thank you for the invitation. Finally, the laptop is working, so. Because when we talk about ISIS, we have to use some pictures to make it a little bit fun. What I will do tonight is very simple. I will talk about 45 minutes. I will ask three questions first, and in order to answer the three questions, or in answering the three questions, I will construct the idea that I have, or present the idea that I will construct for the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, known as ISIS or ISIL or Daesh in Arabic. But I want to say first that there are two things that scholars are doing when it comes to ISIS. Most scholars are consumed by asking, what is ISIS? They're trying to understand the movement, and they're trying to understand how it works, the hierarchies within the movement, the membership, the ideology, and that's really important, but I don't think it's the most important question. And of course we have many, I will deal with this a little bit because it's important and people need to know some of these issues. The second part, and I think it's the most important question, is why ISIS? Why do we have this phenomenon? And in both cases, the why and the what, we cannot find an answer for any question. That's a consensus among scholars. We cannot find answers for why ISIS or what ISIS, either in the Quran or in the Islamic history. Anyone who thinks that we can find an answer for why ISIS or what ISIS by looking at the Quran, a 1500-year-old document, to explain a 3-year-old phenomenon, or the Islamic history, similar to the argument you must have seen on TV, the clash between, or the argument that took place between Ben Affleck and Bill Maher. Bill Maher insists that basically Muslims wake up in the morning, open the Quran, it says kill the infidel, they don't think, and they just go, keep going and kill the infidel. So there is no answer for the movement. At the end of the day, it's a 21st century movement. We live in the 21st century. It's a political movement, and that's why political science departments, sociology departments, anthropology departments, that's really the basic idea why we have universities. If we think that it's as easy as actually looking up the answer in the Quran or the Islamic history, then we should shut down all the universities we have in the world, or at least in America, which I think some people would be very glad to do. So the question that I will focus on in the first section is why ISIS? Why do we have this phenomenon in the 21st century? A lot of people are taken by the violence that ISIS displayed in the last year at least. Chopping people's heads, burning people alive, things like that. Although, I will make a claim that quantitatively and qualitatively, ISIS violence cannot be compared really to the Western violence in the Middle East. And I'll give you an example from John Hopkins' study about the human cost of the war in Iraq and how the death rates shifted between 2003 and 2006, causing 1 million extra deaths in 3 years as a consequence of the American invasion of Iraq. But I will begin with my questions, and then I'll try to construct my account on why ISIS, which will make it easy to explain what ISIS becomes important, but not the most important. The question that I will begin with is, why, and that's a question that usually people claim on Islam, and not only Islam, actually most countries in the South and cultures in the South. Why couldn't the 19th century success of liberalism in Europe, essentially with two major great reforms, the formation of the welfare state and the extension of suffrage to the rest of the population, why couldn't that be replicated in the rest of the world in the 20th century? Why couldn't the third world countries of the South, adopt these models and the success of liberal Europe in the 19th century? Because we keep hearing the question, is Islam compatible with democracy, right? As if it's built into this question a blame for Islam. Islam cannot be, Muslim societies cannot be democratic. But not only Muslim societies are not democratic, really, in the liberal sense. Also non-Muslim societies are not democratic. Most third world countries are not democratic. So why couldn't they achieve what Europe, 19th century liberal Europe achieved? Success, welfare state, to help the weak, the young and the old in particular, and the unemployed in the case of unemployment, etc. What welfare states do, and elections. The answer is very simple, actually. It doesn't, again, require reading in Islam or any other third world or South culture. Immanuel Wallerstein, one of the most interesting scholars and one of the founders of the world system theory, says that the answer is simple. There was no third world for the third world. Essentially saying, the ability of Europe to succeed in establishing these great reforms, welfare state, and extension of suffrage, depended on the exploitation of the third world. In order for Europe to be the way it is, and by Europe I mean Europe and neo-Europe. Neo-Europe meaning countries that were founded later by European immigrants like North America and Australia and New Zealand. For them to be the way they are, and actually economic data confirm that, the third world must be the way it is. So, Europe did not really succeed independently and achieve these great reforms. It managed to achieve these great reforms by constructing a world order in which Europe would be, and neo-Europe would be privileged, and will be able to extend these reforms and pay for them using other resources. The third world lacked that. Doesn't have another third world to exploit. Just think of it like this, simply. Every year we have a deficit in the US budget by about $3 to $5 billion. In other words, almost like daily deficit in our budget, but about $3 to $5 billion. So the government has to provide $3 to $5 billion for us somehow to be able to live the way we do. Somebody else is actually financing our way of life, whether we know it or not. Other places are financing our ways of life. They're paying for it. That's the first question. So there is a problem with the world order. It was constructed from the very beginning. What we call universalism or international order was constructed from, built from the very beginning, from 1450, to generate this result. So, there is no democracy in the third world, in the Muslim world, in the Arab world, because there is a democracy in the West, and there is welfare state in the West. But there is another interesting issue here. The welfare state and the democracy, or public suffrage, essentially were not only rights and reforms that were introduced, they were also tools of domination, tools of taming. Didn't you wonder why revolutions only happen in the third world? Interestingly, the lack of these reforms in the third world meant essentially that authorities, social powers, regimes in the third world cannot tame the population. And populations, when they don't like the system, they revolt against it. Hence goes one of the first really myths about the Arab world and the Muslim world, what is called Arab exceptionalism and Muslim exceptionalism, that they cannot live, they cannot be democratic, they cannot revolt against their democratic dictatorships and these kinds of regimes. So, we have a problem with the world order then, and that's what I want to identify from the very, very beginning. Second question is, we're moving now from the actual structure of the world order to the ideology that dominated, the ideas that dominated the world order. And the common ideas that we have in the world about very much everything by which we judge, at the forefront, of course, is liberal democracy, which I will actually talk about a little bit as well, is the ideas of the Enlightenment, the European Enlightenment. And it's basically, the Enlightenment is basically perceived in the West as a liberation enterprise. The ideas of freedom, liberation, and democracy, and all these great ideas come from the Enlightenment, the European philosophies. And the question that the third world people are asking now, and have been asking for a long time, why couldn't these great ideas of the Enlightenment, of the European Enlightenment, all the philosophy from the 17th century on, and social sciences later, prevent Europe from colonizing most of the world and actually enslaving almost two-thirds of the world population? Was it just hypocrisy that we say something, like the French say something about equality and brotherhood of man and all these kinds of things? But then next day they go and start shelling Alexandria and Egypt and destroy it? Okay, so why couldn't the ideas of Europe, those great ideas, stop Europe from doing these terrible things to the rest of the world? Actually, more skeptical people would ask a different question. Did actually these ideas, acclaimed by the Europeans as the great ideas of liberation and freedom, contribute to enslaving and colonizing the world population? So there is a skepticism amongst the third world people for a very long time about the world order that we live in. And they think it is the problem for their problems. It is the cause, the root cause for their problems. It began, interestingly, in France, sometime in the late 20s, early 30s, when two African, originally African poets and philosophers met, became friends, they were students, Aimé Césaire, a poet, some of you might know him, and Léopold Senghor, who became the president of Senegal later, after independence. And they were reflecting on their experience in Europe as non-whites. As a matter of fact, Aimé Césaire was a member in the Communist Party in France. You can't go more radical than that, can you? And his letter of resignation later from the French Communist Party was famous because he outlined what we know today the ideas of third world or nationalism, third world nationalism. And their question was simply, who are we in this white world? We live in France in the 20th century, and we still feel, or being treated, not feel really, real, for real, being treated differently as Africans, as third world people. Although you have French citizenship, you're famous, he's a very famous poet. They were not treated equally. So where does all the ideas of equality, justice, liberation, freedom of Europe and the Enlightenment go? So there is a problem with the world order. That's when, this is the foundational question of what we knew later as the third world movement, third world nationalism. Third world nationalism basically means that the existing internationalism, the existing world order, is the root cause for the world problem, because it privileges one group of people around the world, one geographical area over the other, and enables them to live the way they do by making the others live miserably the way they do. And then we had all these movements, national liberation movements in the South, trying to get rid of colonization, and they were met with extreme violence, actually. The Arab world in particular had some of the most powerful and heroic, really, national liberation movements. All what we need to know is just if you Google, actually, Algeria, France and Algeria, or even just watch a movie called The Battle of Algiers, you will see how much violence the French actually used in to put down the national liberation movement in Algeria, which eventually won because it's history. But essentially, it made a lot of people in the third world question those ideas that Europe profess or claim to profess and announce every day on TV. So the problem is then we have a world order problem. What does that mean? It meant basically that the people of the third world or the South started looking for models to free themselves, to achieve something close to the reforms that 19th century liberal Europe achieved. You know, welfare state of some sort, extension of suffrage to the rest of the population, empowering the population politically, economically, socially, etc. They were looking for these models. And interestingly, every model that came, which we knew as national liberation movements, every hero, national hero, in any third world country, was essentially an enemy of the West, or the West claimed that figure as an enemy. One of the most important, probably, figures in the Arab world, because in the absence of such figures, you will have ISIS, was President Nasser of Egypt. And no one in the Arab world faced the demonization that he faced in the West. He came to power in 1952. By 1956, the West was calling him Hitler. The Hitler of Egypt, they used to call him. And if you look at the record and see the data, how much he changed the lives of the Egyptians in terms of income, economics, politics. He changed, he actually led a real revolution in Egypt. In India, there was another model. In Yugoslavia, you know, the three famous, Nero from India, Nasser from Egypt, and Tito, Joseph Tito Prosito from Yugoslavia, were like the figures of the non-aligned movement that were neither with the Soviet Union, nor with the East, nor with the West. We are the third world that were trying to construct a block, a historical block for one reason. Because in the age of great empires, as President Nasser said, when you have England at that time, the US, France, Egypt alone cannot be free. India alone cannot be free. Any country in the third world cannot be free. So they have to come together and construct a historical bloc and constitute a force against the first world. That was the genesis of the third world ideas. Why I'm mentioning that, and how is that related to ISIS? Because these models actually eventually failed. If you look at the third world model, the third world's conditions now, you'll see that they essentially failed. Otherwise, we won't have these conditions. But they didn't fail because they were wrong or because of domestic factors. For the most part, the world order that we were talking about originally, where you have 85% of the world resources consumed by 15% of the world population, essentially Western Europe and North America. If you want to maintain that situation, you have to fight every independent model in the third world. That can actually explain the model of Iran that we've been trying to fight for the last 36 years, and eventually we recognize we cannot defeat them, and we have to sign an agreement with them. So, eventually all these models seem to fail. They could have achieved certain things, certain reforms, but they couldn't encounter the world order. They couldn't pull out from the world order, and eventually failed. Let me take you to this then. In our search for models, alternative models, to achieve these successes or reforms, came ISIS. Let me say that again. When I say caliphate, it sounds weird, right? It's a very weird word. Caliphate. For English-speaking people, it's not easy on the ear. Okay, let's make it easier. Islamic State. Sharia law. I mean, you just say Sharia law on Fox News 3 times, and people say that's very scary, right? But let me define that. The caliphate really is an interesting word. It says, this is my definition, we Muslims think that the solution to the challenges confronting our societies are political. Why? Because the caliphate is just another political model. Let me make it clear. ISIS is a dead-ended venture. But the problem, and that's why I wanted to talk about the world order, is we can defeat ISIS today the way we thought we defeated Al-Qaeda before, and then another one and a stronger one will come. And it will also be dead-ended. And we'll go through tragedies again. You can defeat an organization, but you cannot defeat a condition. You cannot change. You're not changing the condition that is giving rise to these movements. A condition that is built into the way the world order works. So, a caliphate is a political order. In the history of Islam, the caliph wasn't necessarily a religious man or a scholar of Islam. But the word sounds weird. And immediately we think caliphate is a matter of theology. It's not. It's a political issue. It's a political model. But why does it sound weird? This is what one of the greatest historians of our times, Eric Hobsbawm, says. Let me just read it to you, because he says, and that's really interesting, that words are witnesses which often speak louder than documents. What does that mean? Basically, when he was reviewing and writing the history of the European Revolution, 1789 to 1884, he says that the triumph of that revolutionary 60 years, was not a triumph of industry, as we think of it. The term industry is loaded with ideological connotations. It's a triumph of the capitalist industry. Industry doesn't have to be capitalist, therefore. But what triumphed in the age of revolution in Europe, in these 60 years, the capitalist industry. But we don't say capitalist industry every time we mention industry, we just say industry. More interestingly, not liberty. It wasn't a triumph of liberty, it was a triumph of the middle class. The values of the middle class became common, became the mainstream. Not liberty as such for all. It wasn't a triumph of modern economy or the modern state, it was a triumph of the economies of certain states in certain geographical areas, essentially North America and Europe. So the idioms we're using actually became common, easy on our ears, seemed normal, only because Europe is dominating the world. If Europe was not dominating the world, the term democracy would sound as weird as caliphate does. But that's what the media plays on, really, how strange the term is. They never tell us it's a political model. Again, I'm saying it's a dead-ended model, it's going to fail. It doesn't resolve the economic or political or social challenges confronting the Muslim people or the Arab people. But it exists because of that. But we have to recognize then that Muslims are not really those weird groups of people who think of crazy models. The very fact that they're calling for an alternative model, that means they recognize the solution is political to our problems. They're not saying theological. That's what caliphate is. But continuously every day, not only these Western idioms are being reaffirmed, but asserting these idioms on a daily basis mean something really powerful. Asserting or reasserting this global hierarchy over and over and over again, and defeating all other narratives. One interesting work about the world, about the idea of the war on terror. We're all familiar with the war on terror. And when we think of the war on terror, we think of American soldiers going, you know, Team SEAL 6, whatever they call, going after Bin Laden and shooting him, right? But the war on terror is really, in essence, it's a cultural project. When the president or any official say it's winning the hearts and mind, it's a cultural project. It isn't intended to deconstruct the other narrative of Islam, Islamists, or who believe in this model, and asserting the Western narrative. In other words, let me define Islam now for you, based on all this. It's really interesting that we're confronted in the media by two definitions of Islam, two conceptions of Islam. Islam is good, and sometimes it comes from the people we know who hate Islam, really. Or Islam is bad. And as a Muslim, I'm usually offended when, like, a Westerner informs me of my religion and tells me my religion is good or my religion is bad. To Muslims, really, Islam is not neither good nor bad. Islam is Islam first. That's a very tricky definition. But essentially, it's a language. That's where the idioms, difference in idioms. It's the language where Muslims tell their narrative and story about the world order. So the caliphate is a challenge, is a protest against the world order. It's the wrong way, but it is a protest against the world order. In my classes in sociology, this is what I say to students. We face problems, economic problems in our society, and I'm facing one, like any ordinary citizen. I would do this. Talk to people who are facing similar problems and tell them, let's form a union. Let's come together and protest or write letters to the Congress or the Senate and demand change. You know, collective action seems to be the rational way. But if I'm not really aware of these solutions, for whatever reason, I'm not educated, my situation is so miserable, and we talk about certain areas in the third world where illiteracy rate is about 30%, 40%, so probably they never heard of these solutions. I might just go and steal. Stealing would solve my economic problems. And I tell my students, when I look at both, the first one is the rational one, let alone legal, right? The second one is a distorted reaction to a bad situation. We call it distorted form of class struggle, basically. Class struggle being poor people wanting better conditions. So you could do it the right way, or could do it the right, wrong way. But in either way, it doesn't negate the fact that the economic situation is bad, and it requires solutions. That's ISIS. It's the bad reaction, the distorted reaction, the distorted awareness of the world, distorted reaction to a bad situation, to a bad international situation. When Messiser and Leopold Schengel were writing in the 20s, they had a friend, three friends actually, called the Nardal sisters. And the Nardal sisters, also Africans who lived in Paris at that time, came up with a very powerful and amazing idea. This is where all the roots of these things come. They called it black internationalism. What they said basically is, the existing internationalism, that was in the 20s. Imagine how smart these ladies were. That the existing world order is the root cause for all the problems we have. The solution is an alternative international order, what they called black internationalism. And black internationalism didn't really mean just one for the blacks, or replacing the Eurocentric world order with an African-centric or Afrocentric world order. But to them, it meant incorporating the rest of the world population in an international order that is not biased. That was questioning whether we agree or we disagree. That was seriously questioning the existing international order in a very rational way, from the heart of Europe, that the existing world order doesn't work. So we solve the problem of idioms then. It seems weird because the dominant idioms are the idioms of the powerful. If the Muslims manage to take over France and win at the Battle of Poitiers, probably they will be speaking Arabic in Europe now. And at some point, interestingly enough, the status of the Arabic language in Europe was equivalent during the times of Andalusia and the rise of the good days or the golden days of the Arab philosophy. The Arabic language was equivalent to the, in its status, to the French language in certain elite circles in the third world, where when you speak French, that gives you some sort of signifies some sort of cultural capital that you have. But essentially, Arabic wasn't weird at that time. It was a good thing to know Arabic, because it was a dominant language. It reflected the conditions of the Arabs at that time. Now they're not. They're colonized groups, and their language idiom is not really important. Take democracy on the other hand. See how powerful the language of the powerful. Until the end of the Cold War, democracy, liberal democracy, didn't only mean political rights. It also meant economic rights. So there was, you can call it economic democracy if you like, in addition to the political democracy. And suddenly, after 1991, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the concern, the economic concern, became less and less important in the conception of liberal democracy. It became more associated with suffrage, elections, things like that, not economic concerns. Otherwise, how can we justify the common ideas, the common neoliberal ideas today, which essentially are very brutal and inhumane? Privatizing everything, That's really the logic of neoliberalism. Eliminate the public sector, which was one of the achievements of the 19th century liberal Europe. Why don't we need it now? Because there is no competition, no ideological competition with the socialist countries. After 2001, really, with the passing of the Patriot Act, remember it was passed by elected figures, right? Not just crazy people in the street. Liberal democracy became associated with torture, as we've seen in Iraq, in prisons, rendition, and that's all legal. And it's carried out in democratic ways. But you would still, imagine this, you would seem very weird and crazy and strange to call on, say, TV and question the notion of liberal democracy. And say it's a Western-oriented idea, it's a tool of foreign policy, whatever you want to say. Is the idea clear? Right? So we would expect that in this world order, where 15% of, where 85% of the world population, who for the most part actually have all the resources, consume only 15% of the resources. There is no logic to explain, justify in numbers or otherwise, in economics, politics, any way you will like. Justify why Europe and North America, Europe and near Europe, live the way they do without what an old German philosopher called Rosa Luxemburg called the third market. The idea of the third market is if capitalists in the West make their money and wealth and profits by selling to capitalists like them in the same country, and to workers in that country, we cannot explain why the West is rich the way it is. There is a third market, and that is what we know as the third world today. So, the third world needs another third world to become like the West. That was one option. And such a thing doesn't exist unless we discover another planet. The other option would be to fix the existing world order. Yes, we can kill ISIS. We are militarily powerful enough to deal with that. You can eliminate one organization. We thought we did with Al-Qaeda, then we got ISIS, which is more dangerous. And if we eliminate Al-Qaeda, ISIS also, you know, in the military security sense, we will get a more dangerous one. Okay, so that's really the basic idea, but we have to always remember, as I said, when we talk about caliphate, I mean, during the socialist, when we had the socialist camp in the world before 1991, we also used to hear about different models, dictatorship of the proletariat, popular democracy, all sorts of political models. But when you translate it in English, especially when you interject the idea of democracy in it, it still sounds okay. When we say caliphate, I mean the most common word, Arabic word, that people know is jihad. And that's a bad word, of course, in the Western awareness. So imagine any Arabic word would still really be perceived similarly. In other words, the idea here is a caliphate is essentially a metaphor for an existing struggle, for the struggle between Muslims' aspiration to reorder the post-colonial world, the Arab world in the after the Second World War, essentially, when they gained independence, but colonial relations, colonialism, continue to exist. Not in military form, but in economic form this time, what we call neocolonization. in economic forms and political forms, they became dependent on the West, essentially, because that situation was structured during the colonial time. Okay. So this is an exercise, really, in world making. Let me take you back. At the same time that the Nardal's sisters, one of the most smartest, I guess, one of them is called Jane, who came up with the phrase, we're talking about alternative internationalism. Some people in the Muslim world began to think about how can we confront all these challenges, colonization, poverty, you name it. They came up with the idea of the caliphate, the Islamic State. In other words, if they didn't have these problems, nobody would have thought like we need another solution, we need another model. So it's one of those debates. We have debates all over the world, the third world, about how can we solve our problems. Of course, you have the segment that think that we just have to adopt the Western model. And if you don't, if you still argue, make this argument, then you haven't been aware of what's been happening for the last 70 years. That actually most, if not all, third world countries, for the most part, adopted the Western model, and it didn't solve their problems. They couldn't achieve the reforms the West Europe achieved in the 19th century, because the resources were not there. They needed another third world, or at least, they couldn't even control their own resources that was used to finance the way the West lives. So, this is just an exercise then in the world making, a questioning of the existing world order. This is, I think, just a sketch why we have ISIS. One little idea that I wanted to mention to you. In one of the famous books, actually the idea that I mentioned, who are we in this white world, that came early. Caesar himself presented us with two ideas that are actually in two monographs or two books. The first is Discourse on Negritude, which negritude is the idea of being proud of being black. Really? But essentially that was the foundational idea of the third world, nationalism. And later it was followed by questioning the world order clearly in Discourse on Colonialism. And Discourse on Colonialism essentially questions not only the world order. I'm distinguishing between two things here. The world order as a structure, and the ideas that support and justify that world order, and in this case, they are the Enlightenment ideas. Now, there's a wide movement in the West, intellectual movement in the West, in most disciplines, really. There is an aspect of questioning or the Western modernity, or skepticism regarding Western modernity. Actually, we were speaking about that during the dinner, and I was talking about, I mentioned the idea how most modern sciences involve aspects of social control. Think of demography. It has positive, or what we call functional, economic functions. We can know how many people we have, ages, so we know how many schools we need, how many hospitals we need, whether we need redistricting for elections or not. But the basic idea remains, which is something we don't see, the taming of the population that these disciplines play. That to know the to control the population, you need to know it. And no other discipline does it better than demography. That's an argument that was made by the French philosopher Michel Foucault, actually, about these, what he called practical sciences. So we have one way of questioning the ideas of Europe, being skeptical about it, from a European punker, if you like. But if you live in the third world, you would have skepticism and you would question Europe and the ideas of Europe from a different position. So our problem, not our, but the problem of the third world people, and I'm one of them, with the European ideas, is not really the taming aspect or the dressage of built into the discipline of demography. It's more serious than that. So when I teach it in social theory, I list all the Western sociologists and philosophers who criticized or questioned modernity, or basically the modern project that began with Enlightenment. And all that criticism come about how modernity creates an obedient individual, disciplines the individuals, tame them, and that actually takes us to question the whole notion of democracy, really. Democracy and liberal democracy in this sense becomes a magical tool, really, to reproduce the existing orders in the West, which is what Eric Hobsbawm actually does. This book that I quoted from is called The Age of Revolution. The second volume is The Age of Capital, and the third volume is The Age of Empire. And it shows us how the social revolution, in this case, the French Revolution of 1789, promoted a certain idea of democracy, which people would want. But there was another revolution taking place at the same time, the Industrial Revolution in England. At first, the French Revolution, the social revolution, was moving faster. So you could expect that reforms would take place. But later, the Industrial Revolution surpassed the social revolution. He interestingly says, the Industrial Revolution swallowed the social revolution. Thus, democracy moved, liberal democracy in this sense, moved from being a tool or a political form that the capitalist feudal lord used to fear into a magical tool to reproduce their order. Interestingly enough, he says, when the Europeans discovered that after the Paris Commune of 1871, when they butchered the workers who were protesting in Paris, they found out that the Americans have been doing that for years. That the American constitutional model of democracy, a settler democracy essentially, really. You know, you can have democracy and slavery. Isn't that amazing? How can you still claim democracy while you still have slavery? You can have democracy, but you can still butcher the natives. You can have democracy, but you can still have racism. You can have democracy, but you still have sexism. So the Europeans, when they discovered that, it took them years to discover that, but they found out that Americans have been doing this trick for a very long time. And what the Arab intellectuals are saying now in the media, against those who are calling for liberal democracy, that we're not going to fall for a 300-year-old trick called liberal democracy. If you can equate between democracy and democratic practices and rendition, torture, what happened in Iraq, then maybe you should smoke a cigarette and think about that. Which is something I would tell you now. Anyway, I would stop in this section and just go to the next section, and that is what ISIS. I'm just going to give you an idea about the movement and the organization. As I said, and that's the core idea, if we're dealing with an organization in the 21st century, then we need the tools of political science, the tools of sociology. And we should not look in the Quran or the Islamic history. And I promise you, all the people who looked into it either didn't find an answer, and those who claim they found an answer, they look really very stupid when they say because you can't. And I'll show you examples now. And interestingly enough, most of the narratives on what is ISIS, the Islamic State, unfortunately, it's coming from people not only that don't know details about the organization, which are available, by the way, for any Syrian scholar. But people would not even read the literature of ISIS. In other words, you can see in the video what ISIS wants you to know about ISIS. And that serves a purpose. And you can read their literature and see what they really are. So, I'm going to explain that in details a little bit when I come to that. This is a quick sketch to this model, new really organization. Most people, when I want to question the world order and trace the origin of ISIS to the world order, so I can make a claim that the origin of ISIS began in 1450. Not when Muhammad, the 6th century with Muhammad, but to the 1450 and the formation of the Eurocentric world order. But in its current form, this organization can be traced back to the late 70s with Afghanistan. That's where the seeds can be found. So the Soviets invaded Afghanistan, the US wanted to fight the Soviet Union by proxy, they came together with Saudi Arabia, who financed that, and Egypt, who provided the weapons, that they wanted to get rid of the Soviet weapons and replace it with American weapons, so they gave it to them, Saudi Arabia paid for that. And the US organized it basically and paid for some of it too. They moved hundreds, well, thousands of Muslims who were willing to fight the Soviets to free a Muslim country, which is in this case Afghanistan. This is when the organization began. They were trained, but you can't just train somebody, you need a doctrine as well. So in this war, it wasn't a war of guns. As much as you need the people who carry guns, they need also a doctrine, an ideology. And the ideology was the Wahhabist Islam, or Wahhabi Islam, which is the dominant ideology, the official ideology of Saudi Arabia. Which is interesting because if you want to fight ISIS, and you want to go to the roots, you don't want to go to the 1450, you don't want to fix the world order, you have to think of the role the Saudi regime plays in all of this, and its ideology. But we don't. They have oil. We're not supposed to do that. In 2003, some of them, of course, couldn't go back home because, yes, we trained you, we financed you to fight the Soviet Union, the infidels, and we're done now, but we cannot get you back because you're dangerous. They sent them to Eastern Europe, some of them to Eastern Europe, to Serbia and to Bosnia. And they fought some of the war there. In 2003, with the invasion of Iraq, that was their moment again. A guy from Jordan who actually fought in Afghanistan, his name was Abu Mus'ab al-Zarqawi, who actually founded this movement, formed a group in Iraq, and he wasn't actually part of Al-Qaeda at all. As a matter of fact, when he fought in Afghanistan, he was part of a separate group that was actually more radical than Al-Qaeda. I told you. Kill Al-Qaeda, get a more radical one, unless you solve the problem. And he formed a group, and later he joined Al-Qaeda because of, I think, logistical reasons, but they go to the same ideological roots, really, the Wahhabi ideology. In 2006, he was killed. And again, we're thinking, if we kill the leader, then the movement will disband. Something Israel would learn, you know, every time they kill a leader of a movement, especially like the movement in Lebanon, they get a more serious leader, and a more seasoned leader. So in 2006, he was killed. In 2007, in a few years, they were strong enough to declare an Islamic State. They changed their name into the Islamic State of Iraq. They did not control a lot of the land, but they were present in certain areas. Between 2007 and 2011, that's the history, the US government and the Iraqi government as well started fighting with the Islamic State in Iraq. They almost defeated them, actually, until the Syria events erupted in 2011, and they found they were saved, actually, by the events in Syria. Interestingly enough, as Vice President Joe Biden recently said, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and Qatar supported this group and another group called the Nusra Front, which is the official branch of Al-Qaeda in Syria, with literally millions or tens of millions of dollars, thousands of tons of weapons. And that's the vice president saying that. So we knew about it, right? Or the administration knew about it. And we still continue to say that Bashar Assad, the president of Syria, is an evil man, and this is a revolution that is happening in Syria. Of course, the Syrian people have right demands, but the latest numbers show that there were at least 25,000 to 30,000 foreign fighters coming to Syria. That's an army. That's not how revolutions happen, where people from all over the world go to another, some country, and fight the government and say that's a revolution. So Syria actually was their chance to revive the organization and the idea. And the complicity of the West, all over the West, you can find offices, even until now, for them in mosques and other places, for mobilization. The French were not concerned about them until the Charlie Hebdo's event, the newspaper's event, that took place when two of them actually attacked the cartoonist in Charlie Hebdo. They never told the people that these two people who killed the cartoonists actually did go on fight in Syria. The French government knew, the US government had them on the no-fly list, the French government was okay with that, they can go back and forth. They went actually to Yemen, where they were trained by Al-Qaeda. We were okay with that, as long as they fight our enemy in Syria. Now they are becoming more concerned that these people are dangerous. After they're done with Syria, or not done with Syria, after they come back, they could become dangerous. In January of 2014, they controlled a significant part of Iraq, and of course Syria later, and declared the Islamic State, which became later known as ISIS or ISIL, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. Okay, that's the history really in like just a chronological sense.